Good morning. I'm Deborah O'Neill, a partner based at Oliver Wyman and the UK and Ireland head of digital. Over the past few years, I've spoken at this conference on a number of data topics, from GDPR to the changing world of data ethics. Today, I want to talk to you again about data because we're seeing a changing and shifting landscape around regulation and certain countries taking different approaches. But we're also seeing broader transparency requests from our consumers and a perception from the public that we need to be doing more to keep them safe online. So in this presentation, I want to look at that landscape, but also more importantly, think about how we as technology and data professionals can really work with our organisations to help them understand the challenges they're facing, but also make sure that they navigate the complex world really well so they can come out as winners in the space of innovation, but also customer safety. So digital technologies have unleashed tremendous growth and innovation for the economy and society powered by data, but we are seeing growing mistrust. Extensive harvesting and seamlessly endless data breaches of personal information has fueled customer mistrust and the data sharing practices that fuel our digital economy and innovation. Without major reforms on the way that people use data and governments regulate it, this growing mistrust could mean that the sustainability of data ecosystems breaks down. We've all seen the headlines, sexist algorithms that don't allow people the same outcomes based on things like gender, people's data being breached through operational mishaps, seeing that governments and countries are starting to get anxious about the dominance of big tech players and taking actions against them because they worry about bias in things that were being shown on the internet or potentially online harm. Some view that government and academics are starting to overstep the mark and people being nervous about their individual privacy and the feeling of sort of a big brother society. And that there are a lot of bad actors out there and increasing levels of sophistication around cybersecurity and stealing people's data. There's sort of three areas of regulation around this that we need to look at. One is the regulation around individual protection, so our own right to privacy, our right to be safe online. The sort of global regulatory setup around data border crossing, data sharing across borders, and how do people regulate for that. And finally, a growing area of discussion around competition and antitrust in markets to really make sure that everything is fair, but also that people are being kept safe. So if we look at individuals first, the ease of data collection and digitalization has increased the breadth and depth of data collection. A decade or so ago, most of our data about us would be known from things we bought on particular online stores, our insurance claims, our banking data, very, very structured data where we were interacting with an individual organization. But now we interact with the world through countless more digital channels, and it is easy for more and more data to be collected about us. So there's a broader range of data available about us, from everything from which mobile mast did our data ping off through to what are we browsing online even before we purchase it. Data that we're creating about our pets and my dog Alfie, who has his, you know, Fitbit that's connecting to my phone, so we know, so people know where he's been and how many steps he's doing and how active he is. But also the depth of this information is increasing. It's not just what platforms we use and when we use them, it's also who else are we connected to. And people are using that to infer our mood about things, our perception of politics. And, you know, there are a lot of positive uses of this in terms of making sure you see things that you will be interested in and giving you a more personalised experience. But that does cause some concerns if it's a self-perpetuating circle where perhaps, you know, you're not seeing the full picture. And this is where people get worried about fake news or very narrow news content, where you're starting to only see things that are like other topics you've seen and perhaps not getting the full picture of the world. Moving on from that and thinking through who regulates that, there's then the topic of, you know, cross-border and international regulation. So people have been talking a lot about, you know, who has to protect the consumer. Obviously, in the EU and the UK, we started off with GDPR. But the slight challenge is that data crosses borders and it can be borderless, which is a double-edged sword. Of course, that drives innovation. It allows new things that are developed in other countries to come to us and we can export new technologies and experiences to people. But what happens when it comes to protecting that pub's personal data? Who is responsible for it? And who do you go to if there's a problem or you don't like something that's happened to your information? And then the final, and we've seen this. So the Oliver Wyman Forum last June did a survey asking people, you know, what do they think about data? Where should it be stored? You know, how do they feel about it being used to create innovation? And surprisingly, more and more people feel like their data should be stored in their own country rather than it being where it's most efficient, which does show some public perception for wanting to know where your data is, almost as if it's like money in a bank or, you know, it's something that belongs to you, being able to almost physically imagine where it resides. And then the third area looks at sort of the changing landscape around market protections and enhancing competition. Most of us, you know, are very aware that there are a number of large tech players that dominate the space, whether it's social media, whether it's web searches, what we buy online, and even advertising is now very, very dominated. And they're quickly expanding to other areas. You know, more and more of these platforms have advertising as a massive part of their revenue structure, but they're also increasingly moving into payments and other value-added services, which makes sense from the fact that they are so embedded in our pockets, in our lives, we use them so often. But what does that, you know, governments are starting to think about, and regulators, what are they should be allowed to do with that data, and does it give them a dominance in the market, or does it allow them to potentially create online harm for people? Not necessarily deliberately, but just through their dominance and not having enough competition in the market. For example, in the UK, the Competition and Markets Authority estimated that £14 billion was spent on digital advertising in the UK in 2019, and 80% of it was spent on the large tech giants. However, countries are pushing back with regulations and lawsuits. In 2020, we saw the announcement of multiple lawsuits and regulatory actions. The European Commission, for example, fined one giant over £2 billion for perpetrating market dominance abuse to its own advantage. So they were looking at, you know, showing online shopping comparisons, but prioritising their own products over competitors to give themselves an advantage. The US, 38 states have filed a lawsuit against one search engine because they felt their results were biased. And China has launched an antitrust investigation into one of its own local giants for requiring merchants to sign agreements and contracts that prevented them from selling products on rival platforms. And this really, you know, this really does show a changing space that's moving on. And regulation is starting to look at this in a more structured manner as well. So here's just a few examples. So we'll look at the EU and the UK, the US, and then China. I mean, there's many other shades in between all of these as well. But if we look across those three lenses, so the variation in protecting individuals' data, the controlling the cross-border flow of data, and looking at protection of competition and markets, each one's got its own cultures and it's all taking its own approach. So in the UK and in the EU and the UK, of course, we've been all focused on GDPR, which gives very strong protection to the individual and really allows them to control their own data. The US currently has no central regulation for data protection of individuals. It's very much state-led, with California currently leading the way, but many other states preparing their own regulation plans. And in the US, there are in China, there are very strong data protections, but they're under the government's control of information. In terms of cross-border flow of data, so in the EU and UK, Schrems 2 decision was stated that that meant there were strict legal standards for when any data wanted to be sent to a third country outside the EU, which had not already had EU determination. And it basically meant the level of protection is equivalent to what you would get inside the EU. In the US, there's few barriers to entry. In fact, you know, openness is requested in trade agreements. However, the Cloud Act does allow government to subpoena data from anywhere in the world if you operate in that market. And then, you know, China's had their firewall for 30 plus years, and cross-border flow is prohibited if it's deemed likely to impact national security, data protection, or public interest. And then around competition and markets, so the EU has the draft Digital Markets Act, and the UK has founded the Digital Markets Unit, which really looks at online harms. It looks at, you know, what are the allowed activities for technology firms who want to expand their reach, and how do they do that, and which regulation do they fall under. The US currently has no regulations. Non-US companies are very easily allowed to operate without restriction. And of course, that's the home to some of the largest Western tech giants. And in China, they have some of the largest data and internet companies in the world, which receive significant investment from government. But it's very hard for anyone outside China to enter that, just due to the firewall restrictions. So it's very interesting. You can already start seeing that data, which is, you know, meant to be sort of a fluid activity that can be shared, you know, relatively easily between parties, as the world becomes more fragmented, that could mean that there have become increasing barriers to being able to share and change data. So this really becomes a critical moment for the world. Just as we need global coordination on climate, we need to have global coordination to build back trust in data. And it's also a key moment for UK leadership. The UK is hosting the G7 this year and is really seeking consensus on data as a topic. So if we move on to think of ourselves and what we can be doing in this space. So if we think of ourselves as consumers, I think, you know, consumers are increasingly looking to request more transparency. They want to understand, why are you collecting the data you're collecting? What are you going to do with it? What will it impact in terms of decisions you make about them? And, you know, what value exchange are they getting for sharing that data? So for those of us who understand data, you know, we should really be making sure we request more transparency about the data. We ask more questions about what are we opting into. I'm sure most of us are guilty of quickly accepting the T's and C's without really reading them properly and, you know, making sure that, you know, you actually do read them and you understand what you're saying yes to, so that you're not defaultly opting into something that you later feel is uncomfortable. And we should be challenging companies on that because we understand it. But also there's an increasing view of, you know, actually using data for the broader societal good and, you know, finding companies that align with your values and be more open with your data, those companies where you trust them in terms of their ethics, but also you trust what they're trying to achieve. And therefore you can see the benefit of sharing your data and you can see the value of it being there. In fact, some data advocates are actually arguing for data stewards, where their explicit role within an organisation is to think about how companies can use the data for the greater good. I think last year I spoke a little bit about the London Data Commission and how companies were collaborating around London to share data to solve problems for Londoners, such as investment in digital skills and making sure it's targeting the areas in most need, looking at where should electric vehicle charging points be, using data that says where are people travelling in electric vehicles, where are their brownfield sites that these charging points could be put on. So there is a lot of good that can come from sharing your data, but you need to make sure you understand that the company is doing it safely, keeping you safe, but also that you can see that they are delivering value from their promises. But if we now think of ourselves in our roles every day as tech and digital and data professionals, we also need to be vigilant to ensure that our companies are not falling foul of the local and global regulations, but they're also not failing to uphold the ethical standards that our clients and customers should rightly expect from us. So keep asking yourself, where is the data and what did we tell our customers we were going to do with it? This becomes super important because now that we're moving into a world of modular technology, you know, we need to be aware that when people share data with us, we may be sharing it with a number of third-party services, which, you know, deliver fantastic experience for our customers in terms of analytical toolkits, the use of the cloud, you know, modular components that allow us to do clever things like selfie checks, or allow us to open up an ecosystem to other third-party services that they can access. But we do need to think about, what does that mean? You know, the thing I always say to people is you've got to remember that the cloud is just someone else's computer. And do you actually know where that ends up residing? So really just, you know, keep asking questions, keep challenging yourself on, are we doing what we said we were doing with the data? Has it gone to the places we said it would go? And, you know, really, you know, the ultimate test is, would you feel comfortable sitting in front of a customer and explaining to them where their data is and what you've used for it? And would you feel that that was a fair reflection of what they thought they were signing up for? So just keep asking the questions. It can get quite complicated, particularly when there's third parties involved. But this could be increasingly important as well if some of these regulations move in and you need to be able to store data locally. It may change how you have to think about your architecture as well. And this brings on to a topic that I think is becoming increasingly relevant day to day, which is this trade-off between customer experience and ongoing security. And in some ways, I mean security, I mean trust as well with our customers. So I think we've all got used to a world where everything's very one click. You know, you can buy something very quickly, or you can, reuse preloaded information either on your phone or through your sort of e-wallet that allows you to buy things without getting your card out every time. And it remembers very helpful information like your address and, you know, all the information that allows you to buy quickly. And that's great. And it sort of, you know, is very seamless and enjoyable. But we need to also be thinking about the downside of that, which is there are people who are being frauded through people, you know, telling them that they're going to offer them a service, or, you know, tricking them into thinking they're their bank. So we need to be thinking, what other checks and controls do we need to be putting in? Which might be slightly annoying because they add a step in that's friction, but ultimately do build better trust and security in the long term because people don't get hurt. There's one bank I can think of where they've added a screen in between pressing a payment send and it actually going to say, what is this thing for? And it gives you four or five checks, things you can check from. And it gives you a few questions to answer yourself, such as if you're saying you're buying for goods and services, well, do they really exist? And, you know, do they, you know, will you get those goods and services? So just little checkpoints that allow you to take that second and say, oh, yes, that's right. And, you know, for some of us, we may find it a bit of an annoyance and we may find it irritating that, you know, we have to spend that 1 second longer. But if you think that it keeps someone safe and maybe doesn't stop them losing money, then maybe it's worth it. So this is this balance that you've got to look for, which is you're constantly looking for more growth, new products, customer acquisition, that really exciting experience. But does that mean you're trading off for fewer controls that would slow down your process and worsen the user experience? And these things are, you know, not the same for every situation, you know, depending on what industry you work in, what type of client you work with. And this is why you need to be constantly asking yourselves, you know, why are we doing this? And is this the right thing to do? And I, you know, like to have sort of three checkpoints I'm using when I'm thinking about this. One, which is examining the trade-offs. So if I can make something very slick, what's the risk I'm putting someone under? It might be nothing, so it's fine. Or, you know, maybe it's too slick at the moment and we need to introduce it slowly through some customer journey that allows us to step people through it, and maybe then they can choose to opt in or out later. But, you know, maybe it's the wrong thing to go straight to that seamless one click and you've spent the money. So, you know, looking at those trade-offs continuously, having very clear design principles that you use as an organization. And there's a lot of new technology developing out there, but you need to be true to yourselves, both in terms of your branding, you know, what do your customers expect from you? If you are known as a very sort of traditional, safe family brand, then maybe going to the very cutting edge technology isn't the right thing to do. But being very consistent on how you apply design principles. And finally, really thinking through, you know, how do you continuously improve? You know, you put a service out there, that's usually not the end of it. You know, either we're developing minimum viable products, MVPs, that we want to share with people to get feedback. But even when we think we've launched the finished product, you know, it's never truly finished because things change. So using those three steps, I find useful. So the trade-offs, as we've said, you know, thinking through what's a customer responsibility versus an organizational responsibility, giving people control versus do it for me. So do it for me is just make it all happen, but in control might be asking a few questions, as we've mentioned. You know, trading off, you know, running fast and breaking things. So quite often in, you know, very innovative spaces, the idea is to get something out there. If it doesn't work, you change it. But that might not be the right thing for you if you have a brand that's very trusted and people expect you to get things right. So, you know, you also need to think through what's your brand relationship and how much forgiveness do you have as a brand? So often new startups and new fintechs have a lot more forgiveness because they're seen as new and they haven't got that long-term trust of, you know, an old bank where people really see you as safe and, sort of responsible. So, you know, even within each organization, the level of speed that you can go at is quite different. So that's why you need to have these design principles. So, you know, one piece will be driven by what's the organizational's comfort with risk in their own, you know, setting, whether that's their customers, you know, what's their vulnerability like, you know, the risk in terms of reputational risk, but also operational risk if you need to put things right. Maybe if you've got huge numbers of customers, then the cost of that is much higher. You also need to understand your customers. You know, not everyone's customers are the same. So understanding what do they expect. Also, what's their level of digital expertise and knowledge? And then finally, what's your platform capable of? You know, there's, you know, some technologies require you to already have quite a modern, you know, cloud-based platform. If you're still on that journey, perhaps you need to go stepwise on this journey. So using these principles to just constantly make sure what you're doing and innovating is true to yourselves as an organization. And finally, you know, continuous improvement. And I really see this as two levels. There's sort of a way you speak to your customer and how do you continually improve with them. So obviously the feedback you get when they use the technology, but also thinking through, you know, reviewing and permissioning, you know, being very transparent with people about what they've opted in and out of, making sure you're using the latest authentication. So whether that's, you know, now we're all using Face ID, do you implement that into your system? Do you, you know, still use the card reader, whatever it is, but trying to stay up to date on, you know, what's considered good authentication of customers. Keeping things simple, you know, make sure that you, you know, don't try and make it so one click that you don't have enough screen space to explain something to people. Sometimes, you know, a simple 3-page swipe of an app might actually help people understand it better, even if it does feel slightly longer as a journey, but you do want them to feel safe. And then finally, actually making your T's and C's mean something. Make them simple and easily digestible. We've seen a lot of organisations now try and rewrite their T's and C's in short bullet points with examples and trying to use a sort of reading age of 12, which should hopefully allow them to, you know, understand what they're signing up for. And then internally, you know, you need to be constantly proactively monitoring. You want to spot issues before your customers do so you can put them right. Making sure you've got security by design. So if you do introduce a new third-party software or a new piece of technology, that you've segmented your core data in a way that you only give them the data they need to supply that service. You don't open up all the data to everybody in your ecosystem. Continuing to understand and measure the risk you're putting people on under. It changes over time as, you know, people get more used to things, so just keeping that up to date. And frequent testing, you know, making sure you're doing your penetration testing of your system to make sure that any bad actors, you know, and new things that they develop, you're up to date and can keep them safe. So just a few tips, you know, to be thinking of. But in summary, I mean, this is, you know, an important area. I mean, data and its effect on technology and our everyday lives is huge. And obviously, we want to be still using data, so we need to stay up to date with what's the changing regulatory landscape and making sure where possible we support our regulators to feel that they don't need to go completely sort of localized so that we can continue to globally innovate. But also, you know, really thinking through all of these topics in terms of the customer transparency, thinking through, you know, are we doing things that should be in our scope? You know, are we partnering with the right people? And constantly trading off, you know, what's the right thing to do for us as an organization, for our customers, and also our maturity in terms of technology. And just staying up to date. I really think this is an interesting space. I think data ethics is really important. I think what COVID has shown us and this whole digital journey is that we need to, you know, really make sure we're taking all our customers with us. And also think about those who aren't so technically savvy or perhaps aren't as well connected because their broadband's not slow or data's too expensive for them. And just making sure we've got that full picture every day as we are running around innovating very quickly. But thank you so much. Thank you for listening. And it's a real pleasure to be here today.